That is genius. I didn't think of that. That is actually genius.
I rest my case.
The end of Bealtanuary. Mm-hmm. So we all painted a model each.
I was struggling with a lot of the colour relationships.
I wanted to try and do the cloth texture as like silk, but I didn't have a clue how to do that.
I think the bit that I'm most unhappy with, when you look at it, for me personally, is probably the bone.
I don't know why it's a discussion, if I'm honest.
I'll tell you why it's a discussion.
He's making a good argument, James. Opportunities to counter.
I'll serve that back like a true Henman special.
Oh, that's a good point.
That's a good point.
So we're all recovering from the cornate invasion of Dave. And it was great, obviously, having him here, which was brilliant. It's always good to hang out with him and say hello to him. Very short visit on his behalf to the UK for various things. But it was good to manage to get him to come in while he was flying by.
I've had multiple people message me. And I know we've had some cool comments and things like that. I've had a few people message me who listen to the podcast who aren't like necessarily super into Warhammer or super into painting, or are into Warhammer but aren't maybe super aware of the content creators and that side of it in YouTube. And I've had a couple of messages from different people who'd be like, he was fun. That was a really cool episode. Who was that? He seemed nice.
Yeah. I've got a few people sort of on the periphery of my friend group and family and whatnot. And they wouldn't normally listen to the show, but they all saw the trailer and they was like, oh, who was that on the show? That looks interesting. So
that accent's different. That must be an important episode.
I had a voice actor for the show. No.
Yeah.
Yeah, no. It's great.
I mean, it was a bit surreal.
Yeah.
Very cool though. Yeah. You've met him before, obviously.
I've met him a lot.
I've never met him.
Yeah.
Just spoken to him and
yeah.
What a nice guy.
He's mega.
I've never met Dave before, but a lovely chap. Good conversation as well. It was really good.
Completely different kind of view on painting as well. And I don't think it's a view that he's kind of expressed in any other show before. Which
yeah.
I think was good.
Yeah, that was the aim. It was fun chat. If you did miss it somehow and you're listening to this,
go back and watch
it. It's just last week's episode. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Highly recommend.
So we did miss out on talking about the LVO, which I think is quite a good thing to talk about because it's a big event at the beginning of the year. It always obviously starts the year with a bang. So yeah, there was some really cool...
Few reveals.
Few, yeah.
I'll put some on screen. Do you want to go through kill team stuff first? So there's the Night Lords, which we'd seen before. Was that just before Christmas?
It was just before Christmas, yeah.
Yeah, but we'd seen the models, but we didn't know the context of... I mean, we could guess from looking at them that it was going to be like an upgrade sprue thing. And currently, at the moment, upgrade sprue thing tends to point towards kill team boxes, doesn't it?
Yeah.
I wasn't sure exactly how they were going to come out.
So you've got the Drakari Mandrakes. What do we think of them?
Absolutely in love. I think they're brilliant. They've needed a new model for a very long time.
I didn't actually realise that they was like an old unit. I thought it was just a new thing, being honest.
But. Yeah, they are one of those units that I really enjoy because there's nothing else that fits like that exact design aesthetic in 40K. They're a very unique unit, aren't they?
Yeah.
They're a very unique type of model. So I'm really glad they got some love, got an upgrade. I think they look really cool.
I love them. I think I mentioned this when we first saw them on that morning when they were preview. But like I just wish that one or two of them had the materializing effect on the model, as in they've got some flames and stuff like that. But actually the model, the way they describe the way that they appear and stuff like that, I wish that a few of them in the squad actually looked like they were materializing or going to shadow. I think it would just add a bit of variation more to the unit. But again, I'm not knocking the models, they look fantastic. But
there you go, James hates them. Confirmed. James That's would funny. Completely redesign them.
Overreaction of the year.
I agree to a certain extent. I think we saw it with a Necron Lord thing where I am interested to see when the designers like to step into how can we make this like appearing or invisible type thing work. I'm always interested in how they can get around that, but I'm not necessarily sitting here wishing for it. It could look cool. Like you say, it was a good opportunity because it's like flame based.
Yeah.
So they could have just done like one of them mostly flames or something.
It would have broken up the unit a little bit, I think. But I mean, not that's not to say they don't have a lot of the flames and details and stuff like that on already. But I just think things like that, like I think that's one of the things we always talk about, adding a bit of the narrative into the physical model as well, just to show how they actually do what they do.
Could always sculpt yourself some flames on there.
I can't sculpt for that.
Have a little chop the models up, add some flames. Bon appetit. Yeah.
You could always go on one of the siege sculpting courses, James.
No, that'd be a great idea.
Okay, next up, Crew. A lot of Crew.
Right.
I have a soft spot for Crute, and I do like Crute, and these do look very good. I don't think I'm reeling myself in from going like, oh, I'm going to get the box, or oh, I'm going to paint that, or whatever. But they are very cool.
You're going to get the box and you're going to paint them. No, I am really, really excited about these actually, because I think one of the really cool things about Tau as a faction is they do have lots of like mercenaries and things like that. Like they're obviously not a combat faction. So having Crute there to fill that gap is quite a cool thing about them as a race. I've got to say the characters or the two different character models from the box look amazing. And
I can't remember their names. They're quite similar names.
I can't remember, the two shapers basically, but they do different things.
It's like, I'm not even going to attempt to try. Yeah. I was going to say bone shaper. I'm sure
that was one of them. George will just dive on.
I'm going to say bone shaper and...
I can't remember what they're called. They're both amazing from what I
can. Yeah, I don't know the second one. But,
so you've got the war shapers and the flesh shapers.
It's the flesh one, the flesh shaper, that I think is amazing because he's got like two blades, I think it is, if memory serves right. But yeah, I...
Well, just look up there. There it is.
Yeah, oh, there he is. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Movie magic,
yeah. No, yeah, so I'm very excited for this because I think lots of fans of Crute have always wanted to be able to do a Crute army for quite some time. And obviously there were some Forge World kits like Crute.
Didn't they get a kill team a little...
They did, ago, yeah. Yeah, so they got a kill team and
I was tempted by that as well. Yeah. But I didn't get that.
Well, if you can't buy a kill team, I don't know about odds on an army.
No, I didn't get it. But I mean, the thing that I really liked was I loved the Crute character in Blackstone Fortress.
I was just about to say they got him in Blackstone Fortress as well.
Yeah, and I painted that and I love that model. I think it's sick.
It's a great model. But the thing is, the range, obviously, other than the plastic Crute Warriors, the only other Crute you could previously get were all the Forge World out of production Crute Tox and Crute or the other like things. You also got the Crute Hound as well, which are quite cool models.
They're still kicking around, aren't they? They're like normal in production.
They are the metal ones, but I'm guessing when they bring out the plastic, I'm sure there's Crute. There's a little like a Diddy sort of like a base best friend on one of the Crutes. It's like a tiny.
There's like a like some proper like full on like rider type things like on these big.
Yeah,
whatever the, I don't know.
Crutoxes.
Yeah,
yeah. I think they're called Crutox Rampages. I think if memory serves correct. It does say that you're going to be able to do a Crute army, which I think is really good. And I think it's what people have been wanting for a long time.
So that's not a sub faction then. It's its own thing, is it?
I think it'll still fall under Tau.
But I think it's similar to how you can do like a Deathwing army. You know what I mean? Like it's like, it's still under Tau, but you can probably do a full force.
There'll be like a detachment, like a force organization where you can just take all Crute, I'd imagine, or something like that. I'm talking
like I know how the game works at the minute, yeah, and I haven't played since like 8th edition, so I have no idea. But
yeah. Crute army, cool.
Last sort of a big one from the list was the Solar Auxilia. It's got a full plastic range.
Yes, please.
Yeah, very cool. Color scheme is like, I found like, because it's just all gray, it was like hard to get excited about. But obviously, I'm a fan of green, so I do appreciate the green on there.
So, go on, you go.
I was saying they used to be blue and gray, like all the old Forge World, they used to be blue and gray, like have like a navy color with the gray, which obviously works really well. The green and gray is cool. I think it looks very royal, which is quite nice. As much as the infantry look amazing, I'm just going to say it right now. New Liam and Russ, I'm all over it. Mars Alpha pattern. Is like it just looks amazing. Plastic version of it, I'll take 5,000 of them, please.
For most people, that'd be an exaggeration. For James, I'm like, yeah, probably will.
Sounds about right. Probably will take. Yeah.
Mordians be getting new rides.
The tanks in general just look incredible.
Yeah,
they look amazing.
Yeah.
The models look great as well, but the tanks look so good to me. Like with all the additional.
I was really surprised that they'd done a Malkador in plastic. I know I know for Marines and Heresy, they've done loads of tanks, obviously, in plastic, which is great. But seeing a Malkador in plastic, I think, is really cool. I think you'll probably find a lot of Guard players might get that kit and use that potentially as a Russ in 40K because it's just a different looking tank. You can make it obviously be a Russ as well, which I think could be quite cool.
What do you think of the Sentinel?
It's a bit different. Again, it's nice to see a different variation of the Sentinel. Obviously, we've just recently got the new, I'll say recently, but in the Cadia Stands box, you got the redesigned or updated kind of Sentinel, which is great. This one's a heavier one, I think if memory serves correct.
It's kind of like a...
It definitely looks chunkier. I think the same things I like about the tank designs kind of follows on to the Sentinel design as well.
It looks very steampunk. Like it's very like a, it's got a very steampunk kind of vibe to it, which I think
it reminds me of like an old school dreadnought, like with the sarcophagus in the middle, to be honest.
That's a good shout.
Last up, we'll just sort of flick through these. You've got the Warcry, Pyre and Flood.
Oh, I did see these. Yeah, no, they look good. Again, those models are always, I've always said this, Age of Sigmar models always, the design of them is just fantastic.
The Luminef ones kind of remind me of Harlequins.
Yeah, I thought
they're like Harlequin Luminef, like very reminiscent.
The thing that nods, I agree with that, from like the legs and the way they're like jumping.
Yeah.
Definitely seems like that. Next up, you've got Arethusa, the Kronseer.
sorry to interject. I think it's Crones here.
Crones, yeah, sure. We'll go with that.
yeah, we'll take your word for it.
I thought this model was awesome. But I think one thing I really like about it is that it looks really like mysterious. I think the mystique that the model has got, again, it's just a little bit different. Again, this is the thing with Age of Sigmar models. Like, as much as obviously it can be used within Age of Sigmar, like you could easily use that for a whole plethora of different things, like even for D&D and stuff like that. I think that would be a really cool model. I am honestly slack-jawed sometimes at some of the stuff that comes out for Age of Sigmar in the design of it.
I was going to say, yeah, it's like another cool centerpiece model
it's
from
just,
AOS.
It's just like, there are so many great models from the range.
Okay, up next you've got Kallus and Toll. So that's the AOS, what do you call it, Joe? Ragtag team.
It's a ragtag group of misfits, as far as I can tell.
Sounds like the A-team.
Yeah. No, I think it's... It's either from like a book or one of the animations or something like that, as far as I can tell. And Kallus and Toll's the main two. And then they've got like three or four kind of side characters with them.
So whenever I see the Vampire Hunters from any of the Age of Sigmar, like whether it's Warcry, whether it's like whether it's any of the Underworld stuff or even this, I just want to do an Inquisitional Force. Like they you could so easily just do a couple of little swaps of iconography and details and they would make some of the best Inquisition models like ever.
This set in particular has a couple of extremely cool models.
Yeah, yeah.
Like I'd probably say like the Stormcast one is the one I like the least. Not even that I don't like it, but I'm just like that's the one I'm least excited about. Like the other little like really unique models in there. Especially the one that I assume James is alluding to that has the two guns pointing out.
Double pistol, yeah. Bad man, yeah.
Oh, actually, I'll tell you what, that one of the things I like, I love when I see these models and they have like, just like old school looking guns. I know it's more like common in fantasy stuff and Age
like
of Sigmar.
Flintlocks.
Yeah, proper old school.
Yeah,
like
black powder.
Yeah. And that was actually one of the things that I forgot to mention, but that was one of the things I really liked about the Solar Auxilio is because their las gun things
look like really ancient.
The way they look is like, they look like old school, like shotguns or something. They're really cool. But yeah, similar vibe on this with especially with your boy with the dual wield in like shotgun.
Do you know what? I'd probably just leave the guns and stick an Inquisitional symbol in his hat or something. I'd be like, yeah, he's got antique. Musket. Yeah.
He's a man of taste. Yeah. He's a man of taste.
Vintage weaponry. Yeah.
Okay. Last up, you've got Zondara's Gravebreakers.
This is mental. So this, the story behind this thing.
I have not read the story, so right. Please enlighten
so
us.
This is an underworld. You know I'm an underworld.
I know
guy.
You're not underworld,
This is one of the new underworlds teams, and the story behind this team is basically Beauty and the Beast, as far as I can tell. So Zondara, mm-hmm. the lead character, the lead of the warband.
I love that you're pitching this like it's a movie.
It literally is a movie.
Is Michael Cera in this one?
It literally is a movie. When you flick through those models, you'll see there's Zondara, there's a couple of like skeleton things, and there's a Beast Man. The Beast Man is the love of her life. That is the story of this thing. I've not seen any Underworld warbands be based on romance before, but I'm here for it. I like it. She's basically trying to reverse his curse, turn him back to a normal ghoul rather than a beast man, I suppose. I don't know if he's supposed to be like a handsome knight or something. Yeah. I don't know. Yeah, cool team. The actual beast model thing is really cool.
It's coming down the rocks.
Yeah, we were already, as soon as we saw that, we were like pitching different like dioramas and stuff it could be straight away.
Absolutely amazing.
It could look
like Beast from X-Men if you painted blue.
If you did it, oh my God, someone's got to do that.
Would that look amazing? Would that not look amazing?
Yeah. Who in X-Men, it's been a while for me, does someone have like a romance with Beast?
I don't think so. I don't know X-Men very well. I
know the movies, not like the comics. I'm sure there's some
changes.
Sort of,
yeah.
Someone comment and let us know. But I genuinely.
Yeah, because then you could paint Zondara like that one, and then the Beast fellow.
Someone
Beast.
Has to paint that model as Beast.
Yeah, I might do. I might get it. Might do it just for this.
Yeah, fair. Okay, so everyone's like, "Oh, New Year, New Army." I'm the least suspecting person to buy into all of that, but on the back burner, it's been on my mind for a while. I've always wanted a Primaris army, and I know my track record isn't fantastic for completing army projects.
I don't know if fantastic is the word, George, but yeah.
I mean, I'm not one to talk.
Okay, well, I'll put it this way. I want to start a Primaris
actually
army.
I got further than you with my Necrons. That's in true. Terms of numbers.
So all you've got to do is build them, undercoat them, and base coat them.
If you build your full army, spray them, and then you do a little bit more than that, then you have my respect.
Well, it's funny you should say that, because where I clearly went wrong with my Sons of Horus army was treating them as individuals rather than as a big whole project and doing everything in stages. And I did that on purpose at the time, because that isn't normally how I would approach an army project, but I knew it was going to be a long haul project and I didn't want to have everything like built and like have to store it and whatever. So I intentionally was going to do them like squad by squad. Yes, that did not turn out well. Fair enough, but I'm a man who learns from my mistakes. So going in for round two, being honest, I was never actually that jazzed about the Mark VI armor anyway. So I think part of my lack of inspiration was like I liked the models and I loved the color scheme, but I wasn't like super energetic about it. But Primaris has got all their new stuff at the end of last year. And I really like the new models. I really want to paint them. And I've always wanted the Blood Angels army. However, I've also recently dabbled with some Dark Angels, so I thought where better to hash this out than picking the chapter for my new Space Marine army than consulting the leading expert on Blood Angels and
someone who kind of likes Dark Angels.
So
I'm not opening this round. So you've already painted one, so you might as well start with that, and then I can mosey in on my Bala Knight Lion and get on with the telling you why they're better.
Well, look. Here's the thing. Look, we can squash this pretty quickly.
This could become the biggest Wimbledon match ever. So
I saw in number one, I'm not going to be as biased because I'm not some huge Dark Angels fanboy. I like them. I think they're cool. They're my favorite first founding easily, but I think the story's cool. And more importantly, the models are cool. And I saw your eyes when you first laid eyes on that Belial model and you were like, I want to paint it. Have you said that about any of the Blood Angels characters?
So this is, funny enough, my issue with the current Blood Angels range is there's not a lot of character. Dark Angels is benefiting from the fact that they've just had loads of new models announced, but I've never been that drawn to any of the current range of Blood Angels characters. I prefer the colors, but nothing's really grabbing me.
So all I would say is that they're getting all these upgrades, special upgrades for different chapters going, you know, okay. And like the first couple of times you do something, you know, you're refining your process and refining what comes out. So when they do Blood Angels, we've seen obviously the upgrades get better and better and better for Primaris. So what you're seeing now for Dark Angels, albeit very good, and I'm more than happy to say that, the Belial model is exquisite, really great model. But all the new Angel stuff that hopefully will come out will be even more refined in the quality of the process and what they've done with it. So I would say potentially that rather than jumping in now at this point, why don't you wait for the thing that you're drawn to first?
I'll just wait an indeterminate amount of time.
There's plenty.
Well, he's waffling because all of the Blood Angels have had their characters.
I love that was just a deflection. He didn't quite admit it, but he almost admitted that I was completely right and all the Blood Angels characters.
All I'm getting at is as well, let's revisit some issues we've discussed on the show before, okay? When it comes to army painting, what do we know? We know that you're going to be painting a lot of models, so you want to enjoy the process. Now, you've painted a Dark Angel fairly recently.
Mm-hmm.
And I seem to remember you telling me that it was one of the most fun models you've ever painted in your life. And that was just a regular, boring intercessor. And what have we also said about painting armies? If you pick the infantry that you enjoy painting, then you're laughing. Because if you'll love the characters are cool.
Well,
you've got a lot of infantry to paint. And if you enjoy painting those infantry, you are absolutely going to storm through it. I don't know why it's a discussion, if I'm honest.
I'll tell you why it's a discussion.
He's making a good argument, James.
I'll serve that back like a true Henman special. Like, what I would say is that if that's the route you want to go down, then I would paint a Blood Angel Intercessor. And then you'll have a true reflection.
Oh, that's a good point.
You'll have a true reflection of what you enjoy painting best.
If you, paint a Blood Angel Intercessor with the same care and attention that you painted the Dark Angel one.
That is genius. I didn't think of that. That is actually genius.
I rest my case.
That is a good... Well, you haven't won yet.
You could have just put the final nail in the coffin, to be honest, if he starts and then he hates it.
And you know what? To start you on your merry way, I'll even donate you some Blood Angel parts as well. So you can spice up the intercessor.
What I will say is, are you specifically gunning for... is there lore reasons that you want to stick to specifically Blood Angels or Dark Angels, or is there a reason why you're not doing a custom scheme? Is there a reason why you're not exploring successor chapters and so on?
I have read Fear to Tread, which was decent. I've not read any Dark Angels lore stuff whatsoever, but colors are cool. Blood Angels colors are cool. I'm kind of like indifferent to the lore on both. I think the whole
But you do want to stick to
the first founding chapter colors.
Like, Angels of Death, you made the right choice. Whichever way you go, you're going to have fun. Like, you know.
I mean, look, let's just be thankful that it's not like Ultramarines or something, I suppose.
I do like that idea, though, like the epiphany of just paint like one, if you're undecided, paint one model for each and see which
I think that helps you narrow down your process and also decide on colors and things like that. It is essentially doing a test model.
But that seems really obvious, but I feel like I've never heard anyone actually say that.
Oh, now you have. No, I think that's the way to do it. And the thing is like you can get a true reflection of what you enjoy from doing it. But yeah, I would argue if you've read Fear to Dread, which is a great book.
I mean, it's obviously 30K, but
just as another little dive into this, it's quite an interesting comparison because both armies, when painting the standard codex colours, both armies have three different sections,
gold, black,
that
red.
Have three different color schemes. Hold on, I would put forward to you, would you rather, both of them have black, so that's fine. Would you rather have to paint old gold models or new bone armor models that look really nice and they're new?
Well, it's funny you should say that, Joe, because that's actually my least favorite part about both chapters. And I've heard you echo this sentiment.
I
do not like the split color scheme thing. And here's the issue. With the Blood Angels, you can kind of get away with painting, providing you're not getting like, what they call the Sanguinary Guard.
Providing
not getting them, any like specialized Blood Angel units, you could paint everything red. Whereas with the Dark Angels...
Sanguinary Guard and its...
Death Company.
Yeah, sure. But I could just not do Death Company.
You can't.
But with the...
You can't do a Blood
But with the Dark Angels, if I want any Terminators, they have to be the bone color.
Well, here's the thing. Okay. So that's where you explore... number one, you don't. Like, paint them how you want. I always toyed with the idea of keeping them green and doing like a bone helmet or something. So it's like the same as like how veterans have different helmets.
Yeah.
That's effectively what they are, is veterans. That's why they're supposed to have the bone armor.
You can try and wrangle that one as much as you can.
So
but we did check the other day about Deathwing and if the other sort of like secondary foundings have different color Terminators. And Deathwing are Deathwing. So they're all bone.
This was what we were looking at because James was saying that he didn't. One of the problems I always had is, like you said, I don't really like that you have to paint three different color schemes. The thing is with Blood Angels is I think you are going to run into that if you want to do a Blood Angel army,
you have to do Death Company.
You're going to do Death Company. You've got to. Like this is point. Like
yeah, but I don't feel like I'm forced into that box until I'm like ready to take that step, like I can complete my red lot.
Yeah, exactly. And then make that decision you are later. Right. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's up to you. It depends how close to the codex you want to keep it. But what we were looking into was whether the successor, because I was under the impression that the successor chapters of Dark Angels, with all their different color schemes, they still keep Deathwing is Deathwing, and Ravenwing is Ravenwing, and it doesn't change.
Yeah. Did you see that like quartered scheme that they showed with the new releases? I think it was one of the Evermetal.
Yeah. Painted that. Is it the dark, like the dark grey and the bone?
I think it was dark grey. I think, was it not green and bone?
Oh, there's a green and bone one.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think there's like a dark grey and bone one as well.
The one thing I will say is that like with the Sanguinary Guard, unlike Deathwing, some secondary founders of Blood Angels have different colour Sanguinary Guard. So they have like white armor, or they have, some of them have, I think, is it the Lamenters potentially have white armored Sanguinary Guard? But we don't talk about them. They're like the cousins that we don't like talking about. But,
got a lot more secrets than they let on when they're making the Dark
Angels. Secrets? Are you having a laugh? Like, Dark Angels got more secrets than, I don't know, like every government on the planet. Like, it's just like.
Not quite a full Jamesism, that one, was it? But he tried.
He tried. It's because he was too like worked up. He
Rage was consuming me.
Yeah.
Yeah. No.
It's an interesting one. I think that's for me why I veered away from ever doing like a solid to the law thing. And again, I've said before, like, oh, I wish there was something that I was that passionate about. But yeah, I think. Why not just do your own? Why not just do your own?
That is the thing. Yeah, but the thing is, you can take what you like from it. So whether you go down the route of Blood Angels or Dark Angels or whatever, like you, like the good, you're not going to game. And I think one of the reasons why, like,
do you know, sorry, I've just got it. Do a custom chapter, and that way you can do whatever Dark Angels units you want to do, and whatever Blood Angels units you want to do. And sometimes you can run them as Blood Angels. Sometimes you can run them as Dark Angels.
I've got a better one for you. Right, okay.
You'll have more fun doing the Dark Angels.
Here's a better one. Here's a better one for you. Why don't you? You're not going to be gaming with it.
Do
right?
two armies. Why don't you just do two armies? Do one Dark Angels army and do one Blood Angels army.
I was just about to say.
Full armies, 5,000 points each.
I was just about to say, you're not going to be gaming, right? So you're painting it to enjoy it. You like both. So in true Angels of their style, paint a bit of both and just have a collection of some of the models you like most, unless you really want an army.
Yeah, well, this is where I'm going to not do what I did last time. I'm only going to buy like individual boxes a couple at a time so that I'm not like overcommitted. Because with the Heresy stuff, I bought that massive starter box. So now I'm like stuck with like however many models in that.
The grey shame begins.
Yeah.
Yeah. No,
because what I'm going to do is I'm going to buy a box, paint them all, and then buy the next box.
Yeah. Yeah, sure.
Yeah,
we've heard it all before from everyone. It never happens.
Blood Angel bits will be previewed and it'll be like, I'm buying them all. I'm buying them all.
Yeah. That's the downside of doing this podcast is when I say stuff like that, I'm like, well, I've said it now.
Yeah, that's on record.
The thing is if you do go down the route of doing Dark Angels, it'd be quite good actually, because I am definitely 100% doing a Primaris Blood Angel army. So
that's the point.
Yeah, so there's that as well.
Let's place your bets. What happens first? My Blood Angels army or James finishes the Mordians he started at the end of last year?
Mordians already underway.
Yeah, underway. But I noticed, James, you didn't bring to the table your Bill Tanuro model. So, you know.
I haven't brought it to the table, but it's done. So yeah.
Allegedly. We'll get to that.
We'll get to that. Foreshadowing. Okay.
I think you should do a tester of Blood Angels Intercessor first.
I want some comments as well from people, they want you to do.
The reason I brought this up was like, I know we're talking specifically about, obviously, Blood Angels and Dark Angels, but for anyone else who's maybe like on the fence and trying to decide, that's why I was asking you to see what the thought process would be between deciding between two color schemes.
You got to do black trims if you do Blood Angels.
I'm not doing black trims.
You got to do black trims.
No, I'm not doing
that. That is another point to Dark Angels, is that the trims are the same color as the shoulder pad.
Also, James, I'm not doing the sculpted pads. I'm a transfers man.
I think sculpted pads are. I think leave sculpted pads.
I think
always.
You go down the route of Dark Angels then, because like
he doesn't want me in his club now. He's found that.
Sorry,
out.
As you're telling me the most.
And he's going to use a sharp knife to do the lines. Oh, do Dark Angels.
Yeah,
then.
Do Dark Angels. I'm telling you this now. The artisan chapter that uses artistic creation to distract them from the thirst and from the rage. and you're going to do transfers. What are they going to
transfers?
What are they going to do? Stents, rather than sit there for ages in the chambers, sculpting their armor, you know, sticking bilonite diamonds.
This is
gems
the thing.
And stuff like
this
that.
Is the thing.
And you're going to get someone to get a stencil and just stencil on the chapter logo.
This
go,
is
go
why.
Join. Go join the Dark Angel Club.
Go on. This is why you don't want to be associated with Blood Angels fans.
Elitist,
snobby, elitist. They harp on about this artistic rubbish all the time.
Go,
what a load of rubbish.
Go join the Dark Angel crew. Go on.
And they're convinced that Blood Angels are cool when it's vampires.
The best ones, mate.
Twilight.
And they're red.
Twilight.
The best
it's
ones.
Twilight in 40K.
You've got to do it. No, all jokes aside, I think, yeah, do yourself a test model. Because you've done that with an intercessor for Dark Angels. I think that way it gives you can look at both of them, go, right, what do I prefer, the process, doing it, colour choices, all those kind of things. I think that's the best way of doing it.
Yeah, be interested to hear the results.
And if you like both, just do a bit of both.
Just a quick one. We wanted to remind you that you can get your own miniatures painted by the world-class team here at Siege Studios. We offer a variety of painting levels and services to meet your needs and budget. Whether you want a centerpiece character or an entire gaming army, we offer well above the industry standard of quality and experience. You can learn more about our services and get a quote now at siegestudios.co.uk. And just for you podcast listeners, you can get 5% off of your first commission with us by using code PAINT5. Now back to the show.
Right, let's do some listeners' comments. So it's been a minute. Adventurers Anonymous 1555 says, this is in regards to the episode a couple of weeks ago where we discussed enjoying painting again.
Yes.
The mindset shift. So he said, just wanted to thank you guys because man, did I need this episode. I'd become way too results focused and this made me really stop and question why. I think I'd forgotten that this was a hobby and I was supposed to just enjoy the process. Had one of my best hobby sessions in months following this episode. I just enjoyed what I was doing, not the progress I made. It's all about the it's not about the destination, but it's about the miniature friends we make along the way.
That's a great comment.
True. Basically just summed up our whole episode way quicker than we could. But
condensed down an hour and 30
minutes. Yeah, love that. I imagine hopefully they also listened to the episode with Dave because there was a lot of that.
Yeah, it was a lot of similar sentiments echoed by Dave. So
Yeah. I mean, that's a phenomenal comment. And to know that it's had that much of an impact on their personal sort of painting hobby time is just phenomenal. So yeah, really, really good to hear.
James Fisher 5930 says, I frequently see content creators and higher level painters using rattle can primer instead of airbrushing surface primer, even though they will use an airbrush at some point in their process. Why is this? I've seen comments from individuals saying airbrush primer rubs off really easily. I almost exclusively prime with an airbrush and I've never experienced this issue and I get a way smoother and more detailed model. I will note that I only get to paint in small bursts, so I might prime black one night, do zenithal the next night and then start painting on the third. So maybe it's related to cure time. That's why I brought that up actually, because we've discussed this quite a lot in recent episodes and it's the first time I'd really thought seriously about the whole cure time being relevant necessarily.
Yeah, so interestingly, obviously this is off the basis of a conversation where I was saying I kind of started using the airbrush primer and I just don't understand the problems that people seem to, like, and even the problems that you were bringing up, like, haven't run into it at all. I don't understand why. I don't know why it's been fine
for me.
Were
you painting straight away? Like,
I was airbrushing over it fairly quickly after priming it, like I would say within half hour, something like that, 45 minutes.
Yeah, I mean,
I was airbrushing over the top of it again. So, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I've had a lot of problems with it and it has come off for me quite a bit and I have left it overnight to cure before.
I guess yeah, I'm like no. confused at the point of when's it coming up? What do you mean coming off? Like when is it
for
coming
me,
off?
For me, it's never been that it comes off. It's that it can come off. So if I mishandle it or I like drop it or something, I'll find it chips really, really easily.
Yeah.
Well,
and it's not that it's like peeling off when I'm brushing on.
No, I didn't mean that. Yeah. I meant that it comes off in that way.
Yeah. That sounds like a you problem. I think you should be more careful.
It's funny you say that though, because I don't remember like
me and James Fisher, whatever the numbers were, me and James, we get it and we can do it and we're clearly careful. We can hold our models like grown ups.
So
you're slinging it about all over the place and then going, oh, the paint's gone.
It's a funny thing though, because I was using rattle can primers and then I swapped to airbrush primer and I was like, why would I ever use a rattle can primer? And then I've gone back to it, but I feel like I didn't have issues with it like chipping and not lasting at the start. And then it sort of started to appear and I didn't realize it was happening until I'd used the rattle cans again. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I
didn't know what I was missing out on until I went back to it.
There was a similar comment. I don't know whether you've pulled it, but the there was another comment who mentioned that the Vallejo Mecha primer is actually a lot better.
Yeah, so I've heard that as well. I think the Mecha ones, they're reformulated. They're not like the, if we're talking about varnishes as well, they're not like the polyurethane. They are, I think they're a lot better. Like the matte, the matte is like really matte.
I'm talking about primer.
What I'm saying is if the quality of the matte in the Mecha, if that's an increase on the varnish, I can imagine the surface primer for the Mecha would be.
Yeah, because I'm looking forward to trying it actually, because I already use the Mecha varnishes. So
I've just always preferred a rattle can and a hairdryer. Like those two give me, you can do a really nice thin layer with it, and because the hairdryer basically bakes it on, like it just it goes super smooth and I've never had problems with it. But
my evidence for the surface primer not sticking well was when, and this I know this isn't due to cure time because of this, when I was doing my Black Templar squad for GD, I primed them and I didn't touch them for like a week, and fast forward 6 months, I actually stripped one of the shins to like repaint it, and it came off so easy. I literally like scraped, I got a little like nick in it with my scalpel blade, and I literally scraped it all off with my thumb.
Yeah, I said, I mean, talk about the, when we get to talking about the Biotanio thing, I had to strip the head, and I saw that as a benefit because it's like, it stripped perfectly and I could repaint it again.
Yeah. Okay. Well, similarly, on the vein of the airbrush primer, Requiem Wraith says, something that might be worth noting with Vallejo surface primer, not wishing to stir the pot further, as the discussion last week was very well argued and explained. They seem to have removed it now, as I can no longer find it, but Vallejo site used to say that the primer could be painted over after an hour or so, if memory serves, but it took approximately 1 week before it was fully cured. This could be the root of the durability issues you experience. Could be worth experiment priming a model, leaving it on, and leaving it in a cupboard display cabinet for a week and then seeing how it holds up.
That could be a good experiment to do.
Yeah, that is interesting. I think a lot of that stuff I do feel like is written to like just cover themselves. Do you know what I mean? Like,
same as diluting the thinner then, yeah?
Just like over the...
No, that's literally the point of the product.
No, that's not... No, that doesn't fit at all, actually. What I'm getting at is like, just in case anyone has any problems with it, chances of someone actually have left it a week is next to zero. So it's quite easy for them to say, oh, we said to leave it for a week and you didn't leave it for a week. Sure. I feel like it's maybe a bit of an overcompensation. I don't know. But maybe, again, we can give it a go and see how it affects it, I suppose.
Yeah. Pete Wilco 79 says, I've got to say two things. One, I love this episode. Dave is amazing. But you guys also did a really great interview, so keep that up. Two, this gave me inspiration to go back to my kid to see if he was interested in giving painting a crack, and he was up for the nids. So that was an awesome result.
I mean, you can't get anything more heartwarming than that. Like, you know, a father going to their son and getting their son into it. That's amazing. You know, off the back of a conversation we have with somebody, you know, that's just incredible.
Yeah. I feel like we need to probably send that comment to Dave because I think he'll quite enjoy that. Yeah.
Yeah. Faces and Bases says, this is in regards to, you know, we spoke about having your big light on when you're painting.
I'm just on the back of that. I am solidly big light off now. I'm loving it. Big light off, lamp on. I can focus so much easier. I can actually see everything better.
Hopefully the international listeners get that reference. The big light. That's what we Brits call the ceiling light.
is that not a...
That's not a thing.
How do they differentiate between their lights?
The main lights or the room lights?
They're both the same thing.
I feel like that's a quintessentially British thing to say. The big lights.
Yeah.
It's something that we all agreed we're all going to say, but no one ever actually had a conversation about.
Oh, well, there you go. It's the big light.
Yeah. Faces and Bases says, brilliant chat as always. I gave George's suggestion of painting under just the lamplight a go with no ceiling light. For me, sadly, I felt like I was being interrogated for crimes against painting. P.S. found some shallow Tupperware in TK Maxx this weekend.
Oh, what a lad. what a lad. Yes.
Old school reference.
Yeah, good. Well, first things first. Yeah, I've tried it as well. And I've always preferred having ambient room lighting on as well.
Well, hang on. Because we've got Wannabe Painter 1 says, tried only having my painting light on, the one from the seed shop with no room light. Instant difference. Colors are definitely clearer, but I feel more zoned in and focused. Great hobby hack. Love the podcast.
Perfect. The problem is, James doesn't care if anything is more beneficial. He won't change a thing that he does.
I've noticed that with the podcast,
yeah. To the point of where he will not now dilute his thinner.
Out of spite.
No. Just purely because he will not, absolutely will not take anything on board and admit that something else might be a better idea. If that's the way he's always done it, that is the way he's doing it.
I'm going to say something. The perfect example of that is the BL Tanneray. What did you call it?
Morganuary.
On the first week of a yearly challenge.
I'm painting.
The first week.
I'm painting Malgan Ra, and he's what I'm painting for BL Tanneray, and his name works for Morganuary. So it works. So I called him that. Simple as that. Yeah. And I still tag BL Tanneray. Thank you very much. But on your
general
point,
trend for this podcast is we all come to these conclusions. We say, oh, what a great idea. You've changed my mind. And James goes, no, not doing it.
No, I'm not doing it. No.
Next question. I'm being victimized here. Come on.
Like, no, I think it's a fair point. Yeah, I think you just prefer to do things the way that you do your things.
Yeah.
It's like anything we come up with, you're like, no, like to the point of a sharp blade might be better to cut something. No, I prefer a blunt blade.
I actually am so used to using my old blade that I've used for ages. I'm so used to using it that it makes no difference or odds to me. I still get the model really clean. So, I don't feel the need to whack on the brand new blade to do that. But yeah.
I just think it's almost you've literally explained that whole thing with the two last comments that you read, because one of them was saying, tried that and it didn't work. And the other one was saying, tried that and it changed my life pretty much.
But that's different.
Everything works different for each different person, I suppose. Like James has his things, and the person who
felt they were being interrogated, like for them.
I love that you said that. Like,
you said that so casually.
That's exactly as it was. Like they feel they're being interrogated by having the lights off. Like I can understand that, because like I get so used to having the both lights on and having that sort of ambient temperature in the room with me and just having that amount of light with me.
I had friends around not too long ago, and we were like about to, like, we were going to like watch a film or whatever, but we were just sort of obviously chilling first and just chatting, whatever, like listen to some music and stuff. And as we walked in the room, I like turned the big light off and put like the lamps on. And they were like, oh, what is it? Interrogation. They literally said the same thing. And I was like, oh, this is just like nicer to me. I don't know. I'll put a big light on if you want.
This is the thing. You just get used to whatever it is that you're doing. And that is your comfort zone. That is the thing that you're like, right, well, that's what I enjoy. And maybe I am guilty of that, but I don't know.
It's not okay to be guilty. It's just funny.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
Topic for this week is, of course, the end of BL Tanneray. Mm-hmm. So we all painted a model each, but we'd go over how we painted them, the results, what we were happy with, what we learned. And then we'll go through the user submissions as well from the community. James, misunderstood the assignment once again. This is like Genesis chapter round two.
No, I think we've got to give him some credit. He's still painted something that fits in. It fits in like
a glove.
Yeah, there's literally no problem with the model.
Yeah, there's literally zero problem.
My issue with the model is...
It was a branding issue.
There was a branding issue.
Other than that.
It was a branding issue.
Yeah, other than that.
No. So, Margan Ra, I've had it on my shelf for quite some time. I really love the model. Ben from CS done an amazing job of making it for me.
I was going to say, yeah, sorry. Do you want to just explain a little bit about this was before the new model even came out, right? And was it your idea?
Because I really have always liked the Phoenix Lords. I think they're just really interesting characters from the Elder range and faction. And each one with their own, they're almost like mini Primarchs within the Elder faction, because they all have like a range of troops that are specific to that sort of leader figure, if that makes sense. And I've always liked them. Obviously, Carandris is probably one of my favorites. And that's one of the ones that when we launched Custom Service, I definitely wanted a non-Space Marine model for the launch of Custom Service. And obviously done Carandris for that. But then I said to Ben from CS, Margan Ra is probably one of my favorite other than Carandris. I really would love to have a version of him. And obviously the old model has been around for such a long time. So he made me this amazing version that's really nods really nicely to one of my favorite bits of artwork, where he's firing the shuriken cannon like at the hip. And he's kind of like on a raised platform. And then Ben made the model for me. I started painting it, And as what normally happens with stuff here at Siege, something else will get come in or something else will be, need to be done, and it just gets put on the back burner. And unfortunately, that's what happened to it. So I got probably about 40-odd percent into it, done a load of glazing on all the armor panels and stuff, and started doing little details and things. And then he just sat at the back of my cabinet looking sorry for himself for ages. very fitting for the kind of somber model that he is. But like... But
little crybaby Malcolm Ra on the back of the shelf.
Back of the shelf, go and paint me. So obviously when this came out, I was like, right, well, I could just paint a head to put on the base of a model for my Mordian army or whatever. But like...
That was your initial plan, wasn't it?
That was my initial plan, yeah. Because I was like, right, well, I'll just paint something that I can just do really quick. So it doesn't take too much time away from obviously what I want to do, which is obviously paint the Mordians. And it was only in passing that I went into the cabinet to put something away that a couple of weeks ago. And I was like, right, I just saw him. I was like, well, that fits perfectly. And it gives me opportunity to do it. Plus also... it's a black model, so there's not as much to do on him, in all honesty.
I have a question just before we get into that. So you had it was shelved.
Yeah.
Did you struggle coming back to it in the sense of like remembering where you was and like what paints you'd use and things like that?
No, because they were written down in my journal.
I knew that was going to be the answer.
Just laid that one up.
Yeah, I knew that was going to be the answer. Yeah,
they're all laid up in my journal. Flick to the right page, there it is, bang. And it was only, it actually tell a lie, most of the colours, so the most of the project plan was already written in there. So literally for me, it was a case of just going, all right, okay, that's where I'm up to. Hold the model, look at the page, look at all the stages that are done on it, and then go, oh, okay, so I just need to do that. And then just picked right up.
Out of interest, because I was trying to piece it together in my head, did it have a date on it?
No,
when
I haven't
you started.
No.
Because I was trying to work out, like, was it potentially 2021?
It potentially would have been, yeah. That's a really interesting point, because I never put dates on... I don't put dates on the project.
I was just trying to think of, like, I'm thinking back to when it was made, and it was one of the first ones sort of after custom service launch. Yeah, and it's so interestingly, yeah, it was before the new model came out, and then the new model came out a little while after.
Yeah.
And it doesn't look dissimilar, really. It fits in, if you were going to play a game or something.
Oh, yeah, you'd know it's him straight away.
You'd be happy,
like,
yeah.
Yeah, like, because the thing is, for me, it was like, what's my favourite artwork of him? And that, for me, is like, he's obviously, his whole entire, you know, aspect is all about long-range firepower. So I wanted the model to look like he was firing the weapon that he's got. And picked it straight back up, just looked at where I was up to based on my journal, and then just... started painting it and carrying it on. But I have made actually a change to the base based on the journal as well. I just want to throw that in there, because like I really wanted the piece to be quite somber, and like, as in not have like that many high contrast or really vibrant colors on it. I might only use that for like things like some of the soul stones and some of the details on it. So I chose purple to use for the sash color, the hair color, based on artwork as well. So I'd obviously tied it to that. But then when it came to sort of like adding interest to the black, like I very much wanted to add, I didn't want to go through the range of grays and things like that. I just wasn't too interested in sort of doing gray for the sort of edge stages and that. So I went down the route of doing more of a blue hue, just using tones and colors to really sort of add a bit of coldness to the model. And it makes him look a bit more evil, not evil, but just a bit more menacing as a character. So when it came to the base, and I was like, right, I was going to do like just a grey urban base, neutral tones, nothing really too crazy. But because the armor has got so much blue in it, I went down the route of doing a bit more of an orangey, earthy, kind of not Mars-esque, but adding like a bit of an orangey tone to the mud and material, because then it balances the model quite nicely, and the base complements the armor color quite nicely as well off the back of it. I find with black sometimes you either go a bit too overboard with adding interesting color to it and it just ends up looking like a dark blue model, or you go the other way with gray hues and you just take away the darkness of the black because you're making the edges look a bit more neutral and more vibrant and warmer, if you follow me. So it's a real fine balance of just getting those two colors to contrast really nicely, but in equal amounts of in a balance.
Yeah. I always struggle with, deciding when and where to go neutral gray, like highlights for black. I almost always just default to blue.
Yeah.
Blue highlights.
I pretty much default to blue, if I'm honest.
Yeah. I just think it looks, in my opinion, it just makes it look colder. And
I think
just,
for the theme of that model, it definitely fits.
Oh yeah, more. Yeah. I think he wouldn't look as menacing as he does if he was in gray, and the black wouldn't look as black. And, you know, I just thought that is, but the thing is also as well, is like, you know, the purple and orange can work quite nicely as well. So because of the majority of the soul stones that are on him are in purple, you know, it works quite nicely with that. The other thing as well is that, like, there are little splashes of green and red on there just to work with the purple. A couple of little buttons and things on the weapon. And just really just, you know, approaching it in a way to try and, I'm trying to paint on the character of the model as much as possible whilst nodding to the artwork and also using the box art as reference, because I don't want the model to be too dissimilar from box art, but I want to add what I love about the artwork to the model. So it's you're trying to pull the information from different things to just render that on the model. Overall, I was really happy with it. I think one of the things that just for the nature of, obviously, at that time when the model was made, Ben had no other option other than sculpting the whole thing from scratch or using sort of like a fine cast host model for certain parts of it. You know, you've got two different materials on there. And I find that fine cast does paint up very different to sort of green stuff. You know, it doesn't take paint, in my opinion, as well. So certain areas, you know, I've done as much refinement as I could within the time frame. But I think the bit that I'm most unhappy with, when you look at it, for me personally, is probably the bone. I probably tried doing the bone about three different times and actually changed my recipe originally on the journal twice, because I was like, oh, I don't like that, the way that looks, or looks too warm, doesn't look cold enough, and then the certain colors didn't cover very well, and like, yeah. So it was a bit, as I said, it's always good to do a bit of experimentation when you're working on a model, I think, sometimes. And ultimately I settled on something which I'm like 80-90% happy with it, if I'm being really, really, like,
God, I could only dream being 80-90% happy of a model that finished.
But what I mean by that, is like I, you know, you look at a model and like, for me, I want to be able to look at a model and go, yeah, I'm really happy with everything that I've done.
Yeah, yeah. No, that's what I'm saying is, it's very rare that I'll finish a model and be like, I'm 100% happy with this.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if I'm being too granular on it, but like, for me, it was just like, I think the bone is the part that I felt was weakest on the model, and that in painting it, I wasn't the happiest with.
Yeah.
But overall, yeah, it was really fun and nice to get him finished, you know, like to actually finish a project after X amount of years.
Put a pin on it.
Yeah. Well. Yeah. For Morganuary. So yeah.
Joe?
Yeah.
You done the other, well, the yin to my yang.
Yeah, a little bit. My full disclosure, I feel like both me and James have both lived up to the stereotypes that we've built on this podcast now on this episode, because mine isn't finished, which is my version of James changing everything to fit his own little thing.
It's ironic that we're speaking about how I never finish anything, but I'm the only one who's showing up with a finished model.
Yeah. To be fair, in fairness to both of us, it's Beeltanuary, as in the whole of January. It's not my fault that you take so long to edit these episodes that we have to film it so far in advance. No, it's obviously some of the scheduling stuff, so we're filming this a little bit earlier. But so I'm not quite done, but by the time the viewers are seeing this, it's done. And there's a picture of it next to my head at the moment, potentially.
I've seen the progress photos, and I think I have to say that's probably one of the cleanest models you've painted that I've seen.
Yeah, I do agree. Yeah,
it's definitely, thank you. And you haven't seen it in person yet. That's obviously been a conscious thing. There was a couple of things that I came into. So me and George actually separately both decided to actually do Beeltan, even though Beeltanuary opened it up to full Eldar. We just kind of both decided, and as we were both doing each of the Warlocks, it was like quite cool. However, we've obviously flipped the schemes, which again was completely independent. That wasn't a decision at all.
Funny how that worked out. It's quite perfect match.
Yeah, it's pretty,
no coordination,
pretty good. And we've flipped base room colors as well. We've got alternate.
You've done a black base.
Don't trigger. Why did you say it?
No, but actually.
No, I touched on this on a previous episode.
Oh, you've done the dark gray.
It's nearly black. It's nearly black. Yeah, I just always wanted to paint this model, so this seemed like a good opportunity to like jump on that. I don't think I'll fit a full model into each one of these painting challenges. I might do a bit of a James.
That's
every
kind of
now
the fun
and then
off.
And do, oh, there's a head on the base or something.
That's great, kind of the fun of this whole like yearly project that we set out. Was from the start, we always said it doesn't have to be a whole model as long as you do like a thing, because it's that kind of motivation to do something. You know how people have that, like, I'm going to just paint every day. It doesn't matter how much I do, but I'm going to paint for like a minimum of 10 minutes, whatever. It's kind of like that sort of thing.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. In case I haven't finished it, then I did go for that option. And here's a finished Eldar head that I've done.
Mounted to a half-finished body.
Yeah. I've really enjoyed painting it, though. It's mostly robe, which is my preference of model. I like painting robes.
Why do you enjoy painting robes so much?
I think because I like doing, for both highlights and for like shadows and stuff, I just like glazing. Mm-hmm. So I get like enjoyment out of that. So I think you can do a lot more of that. I don't have to worry too much about the harsh lines and harsh edges. I think even it's one of the things where even within heavy metal style, you can be quite soft mm-hmm. with your application, I suppose. So I quite enjoy that. Just find it a lot more fun. And I think it's easier for me to like, the shape is a lot more like, it's a lot more obvious where you should put light, where you should put shadows and things like that. And I think they're quite easy to make look, but they look good quickly.
Yeah.
So it feels like you're accomplishing something. But what I had an active decision on this to use the airbrush more than I have done before.
Mm-hmm. How was your like previous experience / workflow with the airbrush? Was it just like a base coat and priming coating tool?
Literally, base coating the most prominent color, and that was about it.
So you train it like a rattle can indoors,
kind pretty of much, yeah. Like base coating with the most prominent color, and then potentially sometimes doing a slight, really subtle zenith with that. But then otherwise, just going in and painting the model like normal. But what I did with this one was use a lot of our hobby hacks that we've spoken about before in terms of like airbrushing and
cling film,
temporary sub-assemblies, TSAs, and cling film, which I didn't actually use cling film. I used
a rubber glove.
But it still worked. Yeah. It worked.
Was that just
well.
Out of laziness?
That was, there's a rubber glove there.
So yes.
The cling film downstairs. You say laziness. I say I was just trying to be more productive.
Efficient.
Yeah, yeah.
You're
efficiency,
very efficient.
Efficiency. Yeah. So I airbrushed as many different sections as I possibly could on this. What I found was, just for my personal taste, I ended up going in and trying to reinforce a lot of the transitions with a brush anyway. So it's quite hard for me to tell how much, because I haven't done that level of airbrushing before. It's quite hard to tell how much time I saved or caused myself to go back over.
You say that, but I find that even if I was to brush paint an entire cloth, if I had done the airbrushing stage first, because it's got the correct color under it, it is quicker. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, don't get me wrong. I haven't like fully gone in, and as you'll see in the images, like I'm not like fully box art level glazing all the cloth and everything. But I definitely reinforced a lot of the the transitions with a brush, it just looks a bit nicer for me. There was like, because I'm not great with the airbrush either. So there was probably bits where like other people would have made it like look seamless. And with me, I'm not super used to it yet. So there was bits of like patchiness and like
it's good splatters that and stuff. You still managed to get experimentation in there while you're painting as well. Because that's ultimately how you're going to learn to do it better next time.
I think
time.
My favorite thing airbrush wise was the white on the helmet is, including the shading, is all done with an airbrush. Mm. And I was just using kind of angles and holding it in different ways and stuff, and practicing being like quite tight and soft with it. I was quite happy with that. I had a few like mishaps along the way, and then was talking with you guys about different color choices and stuff, because it's weird with doing the warlocks for Biltan, because there's not really any examples of official stuff anywhere.
A lot of the warlock models tend to be either Samhain or Ulthway.
Yeah, so it's quite hard to see what you should do, and I'm not really clued up on Eldar, so I didn't know if there was like specific colors that the gems had to be.
I had similar issue with
stuff like that. So what I've settled on, and some of this I'm yet to do, but if everything's gone right, then you should be seeing this on the model now, is that I was struggling with a lot of the color relationships, because I'd done green robes. Obviously, it's got gold on it, which has like an orangey feel, which is fine for the green. And then, because I'd done like a red plume, it was like adding red as the color. So then I started doing some red gems and things. And then I was like, oh, well, that's too much red.
Purple all day.
So now, well, what I've done is, or the plan is to redo the plume in white, because there's not actually much white on the model, even though the color scheme is supposed to be white and green. And potentially put some like green streaks in the plume as well. It's already got purple lenses. So then the gems, I'm going to go with like purple and, you know, like the classic kind of box arty blue gem, so that I can then do the blade in that blue.
Yeah.
And then I think that's going to look nice. Pretty much the rest of it's done. The green was the fun bit.
So yeah. I always think that when you're like things like that, where you've got like the model and it's painted predominantly in two factions, and then you're applying a different sub-faction color scheme to that model. Good bit of advice I always think is just break down the scheme that's on there into the dominant colors, and just literally just switch out for the colors that correspond from your scheme. Because then that way, like ultimately, obviously, it's more typically it's bone or yellow and black, and then they have red or blue gems, if that makes sense. So you've got that primary color triad. But yeah, you can just flip it out quite easily. But it is hard, especially when you've got that much cloth and you've got that much color. You've got a lot of neutral tone on there as well. So yeah, but you've done good.
Yeah, thank you very much. Fun. And you did the other one.
Yeah, I did the other one.
Neither of us did any thorns.
Yeah, well, I did. I just didn't
technically
keep them.
You did.
Technically, I did the thorns. I just didn't keep them.
Yeah.
Yeah. I kind of walked through it like a bit more start to finish, I guess. I wanted to do Beltan because I like the green helmet on white look. And then I Google image searched Beltan warlocks and found out that pretty much everyone does green cloth like you did.
Yeah.
So that was an immediate sort of, like you said, it made it more difficult to look for reference because I'm sure a few people have done it, but I couldn't really find many examples of that.
I mean, I at least had, I think it's Drew on Heavy Metal. He has a Beltan army.
Mm.
And he has a warlock.
Mm.
So I at least had, and he has the green robes. So I at least had that to look at and be like, okay, that makes sense. But there was a few things that he'd done color-wise where I'd already done something else. So I couldn't necessarily follow everything.
Yeah.
But I at least had that. I think for your one, you probably couldn't find too much.
Not really. One thing I also wanted to experiment with was I always get a bit formulaic with how I paint cloth. And I wanted to try and mix it up a little bit because I think of them as like more like etheric, like space elves. I wanted to try and do the cloth texture as like silk.
Mm.
But I didn't have a clue how to do that. So I was just sort of flying by the seat of my pants. So I just gave it a go. I tried to use like green as like the sort of color scheme tie into the helmet for the shading, which was, I guess, easier because it was white. It was like a neutral, so it wasn't too difficult to do. But it's very difficult doing soft textures, like because when I was looking at like references of silk, like it doesn't have that like heavy metal like harshness to it.
Mm-hmm.
I think you can get away with that a lot easier with one darker colors, like black especially, or richer colors that like red, because you can shade quite dark with it. Do you know what I mean? You kind of get that heavy metal look. So I kind of, yeah, I guess it's like heavy metal style, but also kind of not really. It's a bit of a mixture for me. First thing, I don't know if you found this. I knew going into it that the models were tiny, but I still hadn't had them in my hands before. And oh my God, they're so small.
Yeah, they are.
Like, I've been painting Marines for ages, and then I was doing Orcs for a while, and they're also like some bigger models.
I mean, yeah, it's a character on a 32 mil base.
Yeah, so that was the thing that I opened the box and I tipped it upside down. The first thing that fell out was the bases, and I was like, oh, they give me the wrong... Oh, wait, no, they haven't given me the wrong base.
Like, I mean, I had a... Not even a new model, a Rubric Marine.
Mm.
And it's obviously the Rubric Marine has like the big helmet headdress thing. But also the Warlock is standing on a rock. Mm-hmm. So, you know, give or take for either of them. And they're like the same height. And
they are dainty though.
It's like a full character that's like smaller than in terms of like how... I don't know how much there is. It's like smaller than a Rubric Marine.
So I can't remember which one it is. Which one I've painted the same one as one of you. I can't remember which one it was. I've done the old.
You done the. It's slightly different because we picked different like weapons. I think.
Mm.
I think you did the one that I'm doing.
It's tiny.
I can't remember. Did your one have the hand out?
Yeah, sword and hand.
That's the one that I'm doing. Yeah. But George had the sword, I'm doing the spear thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, so with that kit, you don't get weapon options for them individually. You get to pick which body gets the weapon. Yeah. So you've got like four arms in the box.
Yeah.
And obviously the two bodies, and they're in, the arms are interchangeable.
Interchangeable, yeah.
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 Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what to say, really. It was good experience, but difficult, but nice excuse to do a bit of a change. I really tried to minimize the color palette pool because what you said, but I didn't want to throw off the white and green was like the it thing. And I didn't want to make it busier by adding loads of colors. So I went for the purple, but I tried to make it like almost a non-choice by going dark and neutral with it. So it is a purple, but all the purples that I've used from like the plume on the helmet to the sword to the sort of little bit of cloth they do have, I've made all of that the same sort of purple. And then a gold, I do see as sort of a non-choice as well. So it's kind of really only three colours and then black for the for the weapon. So
I think it's funny with regards to the, I don't know what the sword looks like off the top of my head, but the issue that I had was like, there was, you'd make this decision on, for example, for me, I wanted to do purple lenses. So then I was like, okay, cool. So purple, I'll just keep purple gems. I'll do a purple blade. And then as you like look at the actual model, the practicality of it is that there's lenses, and then on the side of the head, there's the side of the helmet, there's a lens, a gem.
Yeah, that caught me off.
Gem on each thing. And I was like, well, that might be a bit overpowering if there's literally like purple eye lenses and purple gems on the helmet. Then he's got like, my one anyway, has got like five gems on him. Mm-hmm. And I was like, okay, maybe that's might be a bit much purple, but I can, you know, I can go with it. It's like one on his chest, one hanging, like four hanging.
You've got one on the back, on the bottom of the gun handle as well.
Well, then, I'm not using the gun. Oh, okay. So I'm not using the gun.
He's
got a holster. He's got a holstered gun on his hip.
Oh, I know what you mean. Yeah. Then there's, on the spear, I was thinking, oh, okay. And then I wanted the blades to be the same color as all the gems and everything, because I didn't want to do too many colors. There's literally a gem on the bottom of the blade where it like, but like the blade starts halfway, like the gem goes like half onto the blade. Mm. So I was like, well, I can't do it. Like, that's going to look mental. Like, everything's just purple. So I'm like, okay, so I need to do at least two colors. So, okay, I'll do a blue blade and I'll keep the gems purple. And then I'm like, then there's loads of purple and this like tiny bit of blue. So now some of the gems have got to be blue as well. And then I ended up just back at the start where I was like, oh yeah, it's loads of colours again.
I think because I painted this quite early into the month, it was off the back of the episode we did about colour scheme choices and making things easier on yourself. Mm. So that was, I rarely plan a project in this much detail before I start. Not that there was a lot of detail to plan, but I went into it knowing, right, okay, minimise the colours. You've got the white, you've got the green. Everything else is just a distraction at this point. So minimise the amount of choice. So I've done the green gems on the cloth, same color as the helmet. It's a tie-in. And it also adds a bit more green to the model, like just to make that sort of unified color that they're known for. But
I think for me, I had a plan, but like wasn't happy with it. I think I didn't think it through properly because my original plan on the blade, I've wanted to paint like a fire blade for ages. I've never had an excuse to do it. I've never had a model to actually do it on. And I was like, oh, cool. I'll just do like a fire, like an orangey, like fire, crackly fire blade. Mm-hmm. Doesn't really fit with Eldar, but I was like, I don't really care about that. Like, and then, but the actual blade itself on the spear, I was like, it doesn't really make sense. Like, it doesn't look good. And then it would be purple. My thought process was it would be like purple, orange and green, which should look okay. That should look nice. But yeah, that wasn't, as soon as that wasn't really the vibe, I was like, oh God, I've got to change it. I don't know what to do.
Yeah. Sometimes it's that just because you can doesn't mean you should. That's kind of, I went back and forth a little bit with the blade because I was initially going to do the blue because it's kind of like what you're supposed to do, but it just didn't work for me. Like, it was too distracting. And I think
it makes quite a feature of the blade if you do it like that color.
It does. But then I found that was a distraction because the reason I wanted to paint the model in the first place was the white and the green.
Yeah. See, my thought process is if I paint the blade in a way that makes everyone look at the blade, then I can just make the blade look good.
And distraction.
It doesn't matter about the rest of the model. And everyone's going to look at it and go, it's like we say about painting the small details.
Yeah.
I was going to focus on the gems and the blade and then hope no one looks at the actual robe or anything.
I hope that comes through on my model as well, as to focus on the small details thing, because while I did spend a lot of time refining the cloth and the helmet, there's not actually a lot else going on the model anyway. So I did want to spend that extra time on like all of the gems I painted individually to quite a high level. And it wasn't a massive time sink because they're so small.
Yeah.
But because they stand out so nicely on the model, it's your eyes instantly drawn to it.
How did you find painting the... I don't think yours has got a helmet, has it?
He's got a skull helm.
So yeah. It's not like a normal Eldar.
It's not like a normal helmet, no.
How did you find the eye, like the actual eyes lenses on the thing?
They're tiny.
Like, easy enough? Yeah.
They're tiny.
It was, for me, a bit of a nightmare, to be honest, especially as I haven't painted lenses in a while.
Well, conveniently, this aligned with me joining team magnifiers.
Oh, so. Yeah. Oh, the magnifiers were out for the lenses.
This 100%. Was my first stretching the legs of the magnifiers, yeah. And they were invaluable when it came to painting the lenses.
Well, you're welcome. Yeah, you're welcome.
I actually, now I've got those, I don't actually know how I possibly could have done the white catchlight in the lens without them.
Yeah.
Like, it's too small.
Yeah.
I could have done it, but I wouldn't have done it the right place. I would have had to redo it a couple of times.
Yeah.
I had fun doing it. When I painted the same one as you, I had fun doing it. I loved it, literally. Absolutely loved it. It's a great model.
Yeah.
Really enjoyed it.
If you're enjoying the show and you want to get even more painting tips and techniques from us here at Siege, head over to our Patreon. With the Siege Studios Patreon, you'll gain access to a catalogue of over 250 PDF and video tutorials covering a variety of techniques, from our foundation tutorials to full character masterclasses and much more. We also have a tier just for you podcast listeners to help support the show. So if you want to take your paintings to the next step and make the most of your hobby time, head over to patreon.com/Siege Studios.
Should we have a look through... some of the listeners' submissions?
Let's do that. So I've curated as many as I could find from the community. Thank you everyone for submitting your posts for the BL Tannery, both on the Siege Studios Discord and on Instagram. Hopefully we'll see you all in, Febius.
You can either or it. You can Febius Bile or February, whatever one.
Yeah.
But I think should we stick with Febius?
Febius.
Just Febius.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, next month we'll be the Chaos Marines. So if you didn't participate this month and you'd like to get on board, Chaos Marines in February.
Just anything chaos.
Okay.
Anything chaos. Doesn't have to be Marines.
Okay. Anything chaos.
Yeah.
First one up here, we've got a Panda OP. Painted a, what model is this? Anyone know?
It looks like it's a Dark Elder model.
Is it?
I will say, thank you everyone for submitting your entries, but there was a fair mix of Drakari thrown in there pretty haphazardly. I wasn't going to call you out on it, but James is going to...
they're cousins. And look, there's a lot of green on that one, so it's very close to the old tank.
They could just be using it in an Eldar.
Yeah, it could be.
Is it a Corsairs model?
It is a Corsairs model.
Yeah.
I really like this. The green, red, purple color split was great.
Kind of a similar... color relationships to what we were just talking about, especially with the green and the purple.
Yep. Next up, we've got Krangon. This is the Elatok models we showed off earlier in the month.
It was one of the first submissions from a listener. I think.
Absolutely smashed these. They look great. And it's nice to see some Elatok. Right.
Big ups, brown base rim as well. No bonus points.
No comment.
Like the kind of deeper blue.
Yeah, I loved them. I thought they were great.
It's similar to the BL Tan thing. Like, I love the helmet just being a different color. It really pops.
Yeah.
Especially against the darker blue. Looks really nice. Next up, we've got Chip Mercury. Again, Drakari, but there's green on it. So, yeah,
and
you know.
Green and it's like green and red again. It's like a similar color relationship.
Yeah. A bit more grim dark, this one.
Yeah, it was really the white, the stylistic painting was really good as well. Really liked it.
Pip-Boy 5000. This is a bit of a whip, but.
Whips count too.
Mine's potentially
a whip. I don't know yet.
Really sharp highlights on this. It's really nicely painted.
I was going to say that as well. Yeah.
Model's that?
I think it is one
it's
of
gonna
the.
It's going to be a lot of me doing this on the Eldar one.
That is one of the Corsair models.
Oh, it's another Corsair.
I think there's quite
model.
A few of those. Yeah. That sprinkle
cool
in.
Corsair cool models.
Such
cool
a cool models. Model. Yeah. And the blue yellow again looks great.
This next one, painted by Jim. I like this because it's sort of in spirit. We gave everyone permission to just paint a helmet.
Yeah, and he's...
Jim delivered. So it looks
exactly.
great. Yeah. Really, really well executed. Like the sectioning on the plume is great.
Next up, we've got Heretically Loyal. There was quite a big project, I think, this, but I've just grabbed one of the images here. But really nice
super,
teal schemes.
Yeah,
super
vibrant
teal. Yeah, looks great.
I do you know what? I'm going to go against what what you said a minute ago. I think I prefer it when the head is matching. I think I prefer an all over scheme.
I don't dislike all over scheme.
Yeah,
I don't dislike
for,
it
for Eldar.
I'm loving the hair colours, the pink and green. That's amazing. Yeah, the pink and teal looks great.
Next up, we've got Nebula Tron.
These I thought were awesome because they're more Corsair models.
I mean, they look like are they painted like a Latok?
Yeah, because yeah, there's the yellow on the cloth there.
It's a Yandan, isn't it? If you look at the wing.
I always get confused between they're the same colours.
Same colours.
Oh, well, they flip the other way.
Yeah, right,
I'm not too sure. It might be a Latok, but I thought that might be an Atlantean. No, it's, I don't know. I'm not too sure, but colours are great.
Yeah,
Darcy cool. W. Farrah. Put us to shame with the free-handed thorns.
Joke. Yeah, I know. I feel like that's personal.
stepped up on the thorn game. Yeah, that's brilliant. Really well done. They look great.
We were scrolling through these, I was thinking, please no BLTown with thorns. Please no BLTown with thorns.
Thank you, Darcy, for putting these two to shame. I'm just going to say that straight up. Yeah.
Mithkill.
This is really cool, actually, with the orange and green. I thought it was really nice. The colours worked really nicely. And Fireblade, check out.
Yeah,
Fireblade.
I was going to say, this is like basically what I was describing wanting to do, right?
I actually really like that with the like orange face mask. It's really cool. I didn't think of tying the face mask in as the secondary colour with like the gems as well.
It's great.
Yeah, neither did I. That's really annoying. Good. Anyway, very good.
Crimson Kurene. Apologies for the name there.
I have got to take my hat off to the work that's put into this.
Book. I mean, yeah, fair play. Like that.
This looked phenomenal with all of the sort of runic patterning on the armor of the grav tank.
Not to get too tangential here, but what do we feel about with canopies? Because I know that's a big like painted, unpainted divide, particularly with Eldar.
I think it works with Eldar because it's like they're very like, sort of like magical. Like I think, you know, I just think it works quite nicely on the models. And also look, for painting, if you're going to, don't want to paint the crew because it takes quite a while, it's a great way of not doing
it. Yeah, I think it benefits you in two ways because number one, it still looks cool. I think it adds, for me, for some reason, I don't know if this is normal or not, but it just, for me, it makes the model feel like it is actually flying through like some kind of space.
Yeah,
yeah.
Like,
yeah, it's like a reflection of what it's flying through.
Yeah. Yeah. And also, when the canopy isn't painted, you can just see the little fella sitting in there. I just think it looks goofy. Like on any model, like I just think, oh, he's in his little chair. And he's doing his little, you know what I mean? Like, I just think it looks a bit goofy. So I think, yeah, cover it up. Less effort, still looks cool. Yeah.
Okay. Next one.
And if you're going to spend that effort anywhere else, then do it freehand in the whole model, I suppose. Yeah.
Next one is Johnny Paints stuff.
All dark. Really cool colour scheme. The teal and like a greeny teal sort of like mash up. Looks great.
Cool contrast with the sort of deserty basing as well.
Yeah, that orange and blue looks amazing. Looks really good.
Another BL tan. Josh Robinson Hobby.
Yeah, very cool. It's gone similar route to you.
It's always a hybrid because it's got quite a lot of green on it and the lower half's white. So
yeah,
it's kind
I didn't
of like
think
it.
Of doing green for the shoulder pads. It's pretty cool.
That's everyone.
Yep.
Thank you to everybody who did partake. It's really great to see you guys get involved with us. And it's really nice to see, obviously, you putting so much hard work and effort into it. Like, it's really great seeing all the things you've done. So yeah, massive thank you. We've got Chaos next. Any initial thoughts on what you two are going to be doing for it?
So the reason I specified that it needs to be any Chaos and not Chaos Marines is I don't know if this is necessarily going to be 100% my like Phobias Bile thing or for, like the thing for the month. But there's a Slaves to Darkness Underworlds warband that I have that cool. I'm going to be painting.
Cool. Yeah.
So if that fits in, I'm going to use that, I think.
Well, we said it's not like 40K exclusive. We've gone with 40K names for most of the stuff just because it worked better with like puns.
Yeah, I was
going to
say. Well, the thing is, Chaos spans both game systems. Like the Chaos Gods are in both, you know. So if you
I think wanted... We wanted it to be open for people. A lot of people were commenting like, "Don't forget AOS." And yeah. I was like, I know a lot of them are like, for example, Eldar that is specifically tailored to 40K. But there's certain months where we've done, like I say, Chaos spans both. You've got the August one, which was. The solar auxilia we did say was just humans. Open to humans, which is you can find anywhere.
Yep.
And then April is Apocalypse, I believe, which was adding to your existing army. So you've got plenty of chances to add some AOS stuff. And I think I'm going to take that opportunity on this month. So I've just gone from saying I probably won't paint a full model again to saying I'll paint four for my warband. So we'll see how well that goes.
I have mine chosen already.
What's that?
So I am going to be finishing the Night Lord's Terminator for February.
Ooh.
I feel like you said this before, Joe.
Yeah, but he's been saving it for...
Been saving February. It. Ah. So yeah.
In the same way that he was saving the Morgan Rhaa when he just knew 6 months down the line.
Yeah.
I had a premonition. It's that Bar the Night foresight coming in there. But no, I'm going to do the Night Lord's Curse Terminator. So I'm loving that model. So I'm going to finish that up.
Sweet. What about you?
Don't know. Find out, won't we?
Secret.
Yeah, no. I'm not sure, actually, being honest. Probably just do like a Chaos Marine generic, but I might experiment with some colours and whatnot. So I think I'm going to go not make it about the model and make it about the painting. So I'm just going to kind of just do a generic like Legionnaire model so that I can stretch my legs with the painting and try out some different stuff. I think that's going to be my excuse for it.
Yeah, cool.
Cool. Question of the week time. Thank you everyone for submitting your questions for question of the week. If you have a question that you'd like us to answer on the show, please leave it in the comments down below on YouTube. Or if you are listening on any of the audio platforms, please fire us a DM at Siege Studios on Instagram. This question comes from Scott Anderson 3967, who says, I started painting last year with the Citadel set of starter paints. I think it really helped me with color mixing for highlights and not being overwhelmed with color choice, something which we've spoken about on previous episodes.
Mm-hmm.
I've only just now started branching out into a larger palette. So my question is, what do you think of starter paint sets?
I think starter sets are really good because it gives you a core set of paints that you can approach most tasks with. And it kind of, I actually like the fact that sometimes they have reduced amounts of tones, cues or colors, because it means you've got it kind of prompts that experimenting, that lack of having something. It makes you work with what you've got. So like, let's say, for example, you have one green in there, you have green, red, blue, black, white, and a couple of other colors or whatever. Like if you want a dark green, well, it doesn't come with a dark green. How am I going to make it darker? Well, I'll put some black into it. I'll put some dark blue into it or something like that. I think it actually is quite good that you have a restricted amount of colors within a starter set. The other thing I'd say is that like, from what I can remember, a lot of companies that make starter sets, they might make a few, and certain of the starter sets will differ based on the faction. Like for example,
I was going to jump in with that. Like not all starter sets are necessarily treated equal. Also like a lot of paint manufacturers will have multiple starter sets, but also if you shop like cross manufacturer, I would say starter sets are good because you might save a bit of money and it's also just more convenient and easier. And you haven't got to like, oh, I forgot to get a X color. It happens to be in the set. But I would say maybe think a little bit about what you're going to be painting and try to pick a set based around the colors you think you might need. I picked up a starter set when I first got started painting, kind of blindly because I didn't really know what colors I was going to use. I was like, I'll just get a set because it'll kind of have everything. And I just bought the one that was on the shelf, not really thinking about it. And then that actually resulted in me probably buying more paints than I needed to. And I think in the end, I probably didn't save any money. I could have just gone out and bought the ones I wanted because the set came with a lot of paints that I'd never used.
Yeah.
And it didn't come with ones that I wanted. So I probably would have been better off just buying the paints I needed.
Yeah, I think actually on that note, off the top of my head, obviously, we're all of us are quite a way past
starter sets
now. So I haven't looked exactly, but I'm pretty sure that I don't know if Games Workshop actually do, paint only starter sets now. I'm not sure if they do. The things I'm thinking of are the ones that come with like free models. So they'll do like free, I guess it'll be based on the start of the game's starter set, the model starter set. So
I'll just chime in with that. They do a couple of paint only sets, but they come with tools.
Okay. Well,
that's still good because you get
so,
things.
But that's cool then. So yeah, that's a kind of, one of the things I was going to say that I actually liked that Games Workshop did at one point, I don't know if, I think they might sporadically do it as an offer or something. But I remember going into a shop once not too long ago just to buy some paints, and they did like a...
Is it the buy 10, get one
free? Like
I think that's a permanent... correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that is not a promotional thing. I think that's just a general thing if you go into a
PW
store.
Yeah, so just to explain it. So it's you buy 10 paints and you only pay for 9 or something. Or yeah. You buy 9 paints, you get one free or something like that.
I think as well, it's the most expensive one you get free.
Something like that.
And that includes like washes and whatnot as well. Yeah.
So if you actually, you know, you're walking away with 10 paints, you've saved a bit of money. I think that's actually cool because you can then tailor that and it's effectively a starter set.
Yeah, it is.
And you can tailor that to your project. So yeah, it depends. I think they're cool. I think they're a good place to start. I think whenever you're starting something new, it's good to kind of work out ways that you're not going to overwhelm yourself, and working out what paints are good, what paints you need and all this is a good way to overwhelm yourself quite quickly in this hobby. So
yeah, I definitely think too much choice at the beginning, it stagnates you because you're like, oh, what do I use? And it's that fear again, that false expectations appearing real. But like, I think the other good thing about it is that like as I said earlier, like it creates and drives that experimentation and creativity.
Yeah.
Because you only got limited paints to work with.
Yeah. So what I was getting at was like, it just one thing to tick off that's like solved, you don't have to worry about it. Like, don't worry about looking into paints when you're starting too often, because just get some. And as Dave was saying last week, just paint.
Just literally. Just
paint. And I think though, so starter sets are great for that. In terms of like being a long term thing to invest into, maybe not, because as you get more experience, you'll
start making selections.
Exactly. Stuff, you'll start tailoring it a lot more. Your knowledge will, you'll just pick up knowledge from, your friend painted something that you liked and you asked what color was that, and they said, oh, use this color, it was amazing, the coverage was great, blah blah blah. And now you've got the knowledge of that paint, you'll go out and look for that specifically. So yeah, I think for what they're intended for, they're great, right?
Yeah. Okay. Hobby hack. This is the closing weekly segment where we share a hobby hack or a quick tip with you. I've got one this week. This is going to be another case of George is going to die on this hill and look like an absolute moron for not thinking of the sooner, or maybe I'll open some people's eyes. I was working on my Golden Demon entry a little bit more a couple of weeks ago, and I bought some particular tiny, tiny grass tufts, like little moss tufts, to go in like the cracks on the stone. And I ordered them online, and I thought that was going to be a slightly different color than they turned out to be. My initial reaction was, oh God, I've got to like find the right ones, send them back.
Yeah. Nightmare.
But I don't know why I never really thought about this. You can paint tufts.
Airbrush them.
But you don't need to have, that was my initial thought, but it turns out you can paint tufts like really easily.
Yeah.
I'll be honest, I just assumed it would look rubbish. I've never done it because I assumed it'll just look like paint globbed on tufts.
See, that's what I thought as well. But if you thin down the paint nicely and you get in there with all the way down to sort of the root, like all the way down, and you start dry brushing and like over brushing over them, because you know often like grass tufts won't just be one color. Mm. They'll have like different mix of strands in there. Mm. You can replicate that pretty easily. Mm. And if you start taking it a step further and start like maybe glazing around like the actual basing material as well, sort of like blend it into the scene, I found really good results of it actually. I went into it was like a last Hail Mary before I like threw the tufts in the bin, but it actually worked out really nicely. And what I liked about it was, even if you aren't gonna paint the tuft fully, if you've got like tufts that are all different colors and you want to try and make them a little bit more cohesive but still have some tonal variance, just getting a little bit of paint and just skimming the top, like a little bit of an overbrush on all of them with the same color, makes them all fit a bit more seamlessly in with the basing.
Ooh.
Didn't help with the luminous pink ones that he bought though. So.
That's a throwback. Yeah. Shout out OG listeners who know about the pink tuft.
Oh, I was struggling to remember that, to be honest. But I vaguely remember that reference.
Yeah. But you can airbrush them as well.
Yeah,
I've done that before.
I've airbrushed them, yeah. It works just as well. But
I found better results with the brush painter, being honest.
Yeah. It's because it doesn't get deep into the bottom with the airbrush typically, unless you're literally holding it point blank, nearly, just to get that paint in there. But yeah.
Maybe I'll give it a go.
Yeah, cool. Right, we'll end it there. Thank you everyone for listening to this week's episode of Paint Perspective. If you want to support the show, head into our links down in the description below. You can get a commission from us at Siege Studios. You can join our Patreon, gain access to our tutorials. And we've also got a tier just for you podcast listeners to help support the show. Thank you, everyone. We will catch you next week.